makers of Coldwater Omo.
John Steed had made a most unsuccessful trip into the country to try to persuade Sir Wilfrid Pelley, designer of George XR40, to return to the Heron establishment for a short while to examine the injured computer. He fully expected Sir Wilfrid to comply with the request. After all, few of us are hard-hearted enough to refuse a deathbed request, and George had asked for him. But no, no, Sir Wilfrid was adamant. He said he'd worked too hard for the Ministry of Technology, and he wanted a rest. 5 years at Harwell without a day off. It was too much to ask of an elderly man. When Steed repeated this to Dr. Ardmore, the cybernetic surgeon, the doctor paused only long enough to rasp out that Sir Wilfrid had never worked at Harwell, and stomped off angrily up the corridor. Steed was puzzled.
Strange. I know he said Harwell. No. Why would he say a thing like that?
The Avengers. John Steed and Emma Beal, The Avengers.
Episode 4 of this story, in which John Steed finds certain other characters in Sir Wilfrid Pelley's home, complicate the case of who shot George Oblique Stroke XR40. After Steed had left Sir Wilfrid's country home, Jason, the supposed butler, had returned to the drawing room and savagely knocked the glass of whiskey out of the old man's trembling hand.
You behave yourself in future, you old fool.
With that, the butler walked swiftly from the room and locked Sir Wilfrid in. Pocketing the key, he made his way to the study next door.
I thought you were never going to get rid of that visitor, Jason.
He's gone now, Loris.
Loris was the maid. At least she was dressed as a maid, but her manner left no one in doubt as to who was the boss of the house.
I had it all on tape. It's a question of checking on whether the old fools try to double-cross us. Here, I'll switch it on.
No, I don't think you do, see. I worked for 3 years on that project without a break. And before that, 5 years at Harvard without so much as a break.
See, there's nothing wrong.
Be quiet and listen.
The problem with Mr. Steed, they treat one as though one were a computer. Oh, I'm sorry.
I understand, Sir Wilfrid, but this is an emergency.
They're always emergencies, always extreme cases. No, I'm going to finish my holiday, Steve.
But surely, Sir Wilfrid, I can persuade
you. No.
If that's your last word.
Yes.
Well?
It seems all right. I can't say you gave anything away, but you took a risk in letting him talk to Steve.
The whole operation gets riskier by the day. The original plan was for 1 week.
I can't help it if he's such a stubborn old fool.
Well, he'd better break soon, Loris.
Where's Keller?
Filling in time as a gardener.
Go and get him. Have him take Sir Wilfrid down to the cellar. There's work to be done.
Some half an hour later, Loris made her way down the spiral staircase into the Pelley's wine cellar. It was dusty and cobwebbed, but part of it had been cleared of racks of bottles. In the corner of this large, damp cellar was a heavy oak chair. In that chair, Sir Wilfrid Pelley had been securely clamped. Beside him on a table stood a tape recorder and various articles of a medical nature, such as syringes. The man Keller, whom we have met before at the Heron establishment and Charles Baines's flat, leant against the table, cracking his fingers, a look of anticipation in his cruel eyes. Loris brushed him aside.
Well, Sir Wilfrid, all ready for another little session, are we? And what shall it be? A quiet chat? An injection or two? or perhaps an hour of Keller's speciality. Oh, come now. I thought we'd agreed that questions always have an answer.
You can't stay here forever.
How long is forever? I'll tell you. It's just as long as we want to make it.
Please. Please.
You can't escape, darling. You might as well tell all.
Nothing to tell. Nothing.
Now, don't be stupid. We know exactly what kind of information you have.
The kind you'll never get.
You don't really believe that. We can keep you here for as long as we wish, simply by informing the Ministry that you've been taken ill. Your pathetic attempt to get help through the computer accomplished nothing, except the death of Charles Baines.
Baines?
Oh, didn't you know? Someone murdered him last night. Terribly sad.
Oh, no.
Now, let's get on more conversational terms. Switch on the recorder. Now, we're interested in three projects. Your work on the seek-and-destroy mechanism for the NATO anti-missile system, your work on laser auto-guidance control, and your development of micro-command cells in the XR computer. And we want every detail. Start talking.
This is impossible. I need my files, notebooks, thousands of figures.
We're not fools. It would have been simpler to have taken your notebooks, if there were any.
You mean...
I mean that we know all about you. Brilliant scientist, superb mathematician, incredible mind. The man who never keeps notes because he has a perfect memory.
You can't force me to talk.
Oh, can't we? I've been far too kind up to now, Sir Wilfred. And we want it all. Details, figures, dates. Every part of that perfect memory. We want it all, and we shall have it all.
Just about noon, Steed's Bentley purred its way up the Pelly driveway on yet another surprise visit. Steed waved to Keller, who was working on a rose bed, parked the car, and nipped smartly up the steps into the hall. Jason stared in amazement as Steed handed him his bowler and umbrella.
Morning, Jason. In time for lunch, I hope.
I beg your pardon.
Lunch. Had to pop down again in the rush last time. I forgot all about the main point of the visit.
I'm sorry, sir. Sir Wilfred gave a strict instruction on no account.
Now, you can't try the same track twice, but don't worry. Your reputation remains untarnished.
You can't see him, sir.
Can't? No one says can't to a ministry representative. Oh, don't worry. I'll find my own way to the sherry. You just find the master. There's a good chap.
Down in the wine cellar, almost directly beneath Steed's feet, Sir Wilfred Pelly, broken and exhausted, like a man in a trance, was muttering a continuous thought stream.
Alternate patterns of 4 and 8 star strike missiles arranged on the parallel grid system along the eastern coast with radar links at...
Loris!
Haven't I told you never to interrupt me when I'm working?
It's Steed. He's here to see Pelly, and he's going to be put off.
Oh, all right. Stall him. I'll be up in a minute. All right, Sir Wilfred. We'll give you 10 minutes with Steed. 10 minutes to get rid of him. No more. Understand?
I'll try.
Do it. And remember what happened to Baines. One wrong word and Mr. Steed won't get as far as the front door.
Upstairs, Steed was helping himself to yet another glass of Sir Wilfrid's excellent sherry. Pausing by the decanter, he noticed 2 wires leading from a table lamp. One from the electric bulb, another from a small concealed microphone. Steed smiled and pulled on the second wire.
More sherry, sir.
Help myself, thank you, Jason. Oh, what's happened to the maid?
The maid?
You should have a word with her. Shocking amount of dust on these tables. What time is lunch?
I'm afraid Sir Wilfred decided to have it in his room, sir.
Oh, pity. Well, in that case...
Steed, hearing movements in the hall, walked swiftly to the door and opened it.
Oh, Sir Wilfred, I had no idea you weren't feeling well. Do let me help you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Steed. Mr. Steed will help me, Loris.
Loris? Oh, you're the maid. My, you've even got cobwebs and dust over that smart white uniform. You must be a hard work girl. This way, Sir Wilfred.
I was having some of your splendid sherry. That'll be all, Jason.
I think you need a doctor, Sir Wilfred. Like me to fix it up?
Rest, it's all I need. Rest, to be left alone.
Nonsense. We have to take care of people like you. You could wrap up well, and I can drive you over to see this doctor friend. Doesn't live too far from here.
No, I can't. I'm sorry, Steve, but I have no intention of leaving this house.
Well, you know best, of course. Oh, by the way, I bumped into a chap this morning who knew you at Harwell.
Oh? Who was it?
Tommy Beckwith. Sends you his regards.
Oh, yes, Beckwith. You might say hello to him for me.
Of course. Well, are you sure that's all, Sir Wilfred?
There's really nothing for us to discuss, Mr. Steed. Sorry, I can't give you lunch.
Oh, well, that's all right. Thank you for the sherry. Good day, then, Sir Wilfred.
Steed collected his bowler and umbrella and made for the car. He couldn't get it to start and was forced to examine the engine for quite some time. While he was doing this, Loris and Jason had met in the study.
There's nothing on the tape recorder.
What's wrong?
The microphone. I thought you were supposed to check on it.
It was all right last night.
I wonder.
Loris made her way swiftly into the drawing room and within minutes was standing by the drinks table, the torn-out wire from the table lamp in her hand.
It's Steed. He's on to us. He must be. He'll have to go, Jason. He'll just have to go.
Listen every evening, Monday to Friday, to John Speed and Emma Peel, The Avengers. Brought to you by the makers of Coldwater Omo.